Well, good morning, everybody. We're going to go ahead and get started. I know a lot of the chairs that you're sitting in, you sink pretty deep into them, so I'm not going to ask you to stand. Those are very comfortable chairs. But if you would, join with me in singing Your Grace Is Enough.
Faithfulness, O God, You wrestle with the sinner's restless heart. You lead us by still waters into mercy, and nothing can keep us apart.
So then normally this is go ahead and be seated, but you're already seated, so let's just bypass that one altogether. Hey, I want to welcome you back to Jan and Steve Fletcher's house. So this is our church in exile during COVID. This is what we did every Sunday from July of 2020 until November. So when it was entirely too hot to do it, and then when it was entirely too cold to do it, we were out here. So this is kind of our home away from home. And so, hey, I want to say before we even get started, if you guys are over here and you're just cooking in the sun, there is lots of shade over here, and this shade will stay until the service is over. You guys that are over here, it's going to intensify until it's approximately the temperature of the sun over here. So you might move at some point. Got a few announcements this morning. We're going to be doing a lot of stuff here today. We're going to be welcoming new members into the church. We're going to be doing a baptism in this horse trough over here. We're going to have a picnic and lots of games and things like that. And so there's a lot going on this morning. And so let me get through these pretty quick. We are continuing to work on the fundraising stuff for our mission trip, and so we're having a fundraising dinner. I guess it's next Sunday. So next Sunday afternoon, we're going to be doing an Asian food fundraiser over at the Eagles Lodge. If you have not yet got your tickets for that, we can get those to you this week. Come and talk with me or go to the office. Dorothy can get those for you. It's $20 for an adult two-entree plate, $15 for a kid's one-entree plate. Or if you're an adult and you don't want two entrees, buy the kid's plate, and that works as well. We're also selling gift cards. The Pizza Barn has generously given us gift cards that we can sell, and then a portion of those goes towards the cost of the trip. I told Heather the other day, this is the most Pizza Barn eatin'est church I've ever met in my life. So, I mean, those gift cards should have been gone in a week. So, you know, come and get them from us. And they are cash value, so, you know, they're $25 a piece, so they're worth $25. And so you can use those to get your delicious pizza there. Sue Butler and the Hostess Committee are looking at hosting a fundraiser on Mother's Day called Chocolate Fest. And if you have any questions about that, Sue is the one to talk to. She needs help. She needs people to sign up to bring some things. So talk with her. I think somewhere around here there's a sign-up list for that as well. Aaron's got it over here. So just sit it right up here. And if you guys want to sign up for it, it'll be up there. There's also a sign-up for the camping trip. Camping trip is the weekend of the 19th, correct, Mike? 19th, 20, 21st. So if you have not yet signed up for that and you would like to go, speak with Mike or sign up this morning. That way he knows who all is planning on going. It's going to be a fun weekend. We're going to be up near Lone Pine. We're going to be up at Boulder Creek Campground. So if you'd like to be a part of that, that's going to be a fun gathering there as well. May 27th, we're doing a community movie night over at Randall Field. We've got the big blow-up screen, and we're going to set it up and then just invite the community to come out and have a good time. We'll sell some concessions there as part of our fundraising for Mission Trip. But, you know, feel free to bring your own stuff. You don't have to buy our popcorn, but we're going to have popcorn and some other things that we'll sell as well to raise funds there. Another thing that's going on June 3rd, we're going to be doing a game night, and this was Callie Kane's idea, but it's nacho average game night, so we're going to have a nacho bar. That's what we'll eat, and we'll play games. If you have questions about that, talk to Mary Bachman over here. Next week, I'll give her a minute in the service, and she'll kind of explain some things there for you as well, but just put that on your calendar. And then the next thing, and probably one of the biggest things that we do during the year, is June 10th, the weekend of June 10th, 9th through 11th, is Vacation Bible School. So we need tons of volunteers for that. Vacation Bible School takes, you know, about half of the church in order to make it happen. So Lacey down here has a sign-up sheet if you would like to volunteer to be a part of that. We need workers to help in every area for that. So talk with Lacey this morning. And we'll get moving on that. One more thing announcement-wise here is on August 4th through 6th, we are hosting our annual family camp, and that'll be up at Camp Yenisante. We did that last year. It was a lot of fun. Callie needs help. So Callie is the one who is heading up family camp, but she needs people to head up specific parts of family camp. So if you would like to do that, if you would like to head up crafts, or you'd like to head up food, or if you'd like to lead a hike, I think usually Rich likes to do that, but you know, I haven't spoken to Rich yet. So if you've got something you would like to help with, go talk to Callie this morning when we get to the picnic part and find out what she needs, what help she needs. There's just all kinds of stuff that needs to be done for that. So those are the announcements for this morning. I'm going to ask those who have We're going to welcome new members into fellowship this morning. We're going to start that now. And one of the people that's coming into fellowship has not yet been baptized, but we're going to baptize him this morning at the end of the service because I don't want to get soaking wet before I have to preach. And I don't think he wants to get soaking wet before the service either. But we have a group of people that have said that they would like to join the church. And so in order to join the church, you must be a believer. You need to be baptized, and then you have to go through the church membership course. And our church membership course is just a way that we acclimate people to what we're about as a church. We go through our history, we go through our doctrine, we go through our strategy and what it is that we're doing in this community and in the church. And so these people have all gone through that course. They have all been through, and so now they're wanting to come forward and make their intention to join our church, to become members of the church as a part of our local body. Now, church membership is nothing mystical. It's not something that makes you more spiritual than the other people around you. But what it is it's a statement of commitment. So when you come forward for church membership, what you're saying is, I believe that God has led me here, that this is the place where he wants me to serve, and so therefore, in a public, in a formal way, I'm committing myself to this body, to serve with this body, to be accountable to this body, to grow with this body, and so that's what they're going to come and do at this point. So those of you that have gone through the church membership class recently, and you're wanting to join the church, come on up here and join me. I'm going to just have you guys come up here. And what we do as a church is we do a church membership covenant. And what it is it's a statement of aspiration, right? It's not, you're not saying I have successfully accomplished all of these things and therefore I am, I'm spiritually there. What you're saying is, because I believe God has called me to this place, this is what I intend to do and this is how I intend to approach my life here in the church. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to read the church membership covenant, and those that are joining here, I'll introduce you here. This is Hamish Patterson. This is Kathy Agapeo. This is, tell me the right way.
Agapeo,
okay. This is Debbie Pence. This is Catherine L. Conan, Darrow L. Conan, and Terry Harris. And so they have come forward and they've said, we want to be a part of this church. We want to join this church. And so the membership covenant says this. It says, having received Christ as my Lord and Savior, and having been baptized, and being in agreement with First Baptist Church Kernville's doctrine, purpose, and goals, I now feel led by the Holy Spirit to unite with First Baptist Church Kernville family. In doing so, I commit myself to God and the other members of this church by doing the four following things. And what I'll do is I'll read it, and then they'll say, we will, and then I'll read the next part, and then we have a section for the church as well. And I keep saying First Baptist Church, but we're Kernville Baptist Church now, so the first is gone, since we really are just the only Baptist church in Kernville, so it works. So the first one is, I will protect the unity of my church by acting in love toward other members, by refusing to gossip and slander, and by willingly following the leaders of the church. Secondly, I will share the responsibility of my church by praying for its growth, by inviting the unchurched to attend, and by warmly welcoming those who visit with us. Number three, I will serve the ministry of my church by discovering my gifts and talents, by being equipped to serve by my leaders and pastors, and by developing a servant's heart. And number four, I will support the testimony of my church by attending faithfully, by living a godly and holy life, and by honoring the Lord through faithfully giving back to him. And so this is their commitment, that they are going to protect the unity of the church, share the responsibility of the church, serve within the ministry of the church, and support the testimony of the church. And then we, as the church body, want to encourage them, and we want to hold them in accountability to this. And so the church, this is your part. Church, will you commit yourself to reaching out to these new members, working for their growth and their assimilation by supporting them, by challenging them, by encouraging them, by holding them accountable to that which they have committed to, and by embracing them as a part of this church family? Amen. Well, you guys, thank you for going through all of this. We want to welcome you in membership. So what we're going to do is take a few moments to greet one another. But you guys, if you'll mill out there, greet them, welcome them to the church, and then we'll continue in worship in just a moment. Thank you.
You are my you're the river, an ever-flowing stream of life. In the battle, you're the victor. In the darkness, you're the fire, a holy flame for all to see. In my heart, you reign forever, my all, my everything. You are my life, you are my love, you are my reason, you are my hope. You are my joy, you are my passion, my all in all. Jesus, my all in all. My all in all. Jesus, my all in all. In the tempest, you're the shelter, and I will hide beneath your wings. Hallelujah, what a Savior.
Comes to share the word, that you would give him wisdom and grace, and that we would understand you more, understand your will for our lives, and that you would bless and keep us through the power of your word and through the power of your spirit as we learn from you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
All right. Well, I am I'm one of the most easily distracted people in the world, and so I'm going to do my best to kind of keep my focus with 1,000 things going on here, and I would encourage you and ask you to try to do the same. We've got a group of children playing in the ditch over here. We're going to have horses that inevitably come over and harass us during the service, which is what they used to do when we were out here. So we've got a lot of distractions, but we're going to go into God's Word this morning, and we're hopefully going to come away benefiting from what he has for us this morning. So I want to start with a question, and this is the question that you guys probably could all answer yes to, but has anybody here ever gotten the silent treatment? Raise your hand if you've ever gotten the silent treatment. When I first met my wife impressed me because she was one of the most diligent, hardworking people that I'd ever met. You know, she kept everything clean. When we started dating, I was impressed by the fact that, like, every part of her life was in order, the way she took notes, the way she cleaned her dorm room, everything, like, was just perfect. When we got married, our house was spick and span. Everything was great and perfect. And I made the assumption that because she did that so well, that was something she enjoyed doing, right? that she liked to clean, that she found great satisfaction and joy in that. And this worked out really well for me because I like to make messes, and in my mind, she liked to clean. So I was like, this is a perpetual self-feeding thing. I will be able to provide her opportunities to exercise her gifts and her abilities, and I will be able to continue living my life however I want, right? And this is, by the way, like Homer Simpson logic. This is sitcom husband logic, but it's what I thought. And so right after we got married, we went on a marriage retreat. I think this was the first year of our marriage. And on the day we were supposed to go on this retreat, we got in an argument about keeping the house, right? Of cleaning the house and things like this. And I was confused by this because Heather, and I don't remember the exact conversation, but the historical records seem to indicate that that we were talking about the fact that she had to work and then come home and clean and keep the house nice. And this was confusing to me. And so at some point, I made a comment, something along these lines. I don't understand why this is a problem. You love cleaning. And then I decided to die on that hill. And die I did because she did not speak to me the entire way to the marriage retreat. And there on the first night of the marriage retreat, she did not speak to me. I was cut off. I was cut off. And instead of the inn at the Amish door being this place of wonderful wedded bliss, it became a place of dread and gloom and silence for me because I had made this terrible error of assuming that she actually liked doing this. The silent treatment is a difficult thing. It can be brutal. When our loved ones don't speak to us, or when they back away and they shun us. Now, I know that there are some marriages out there where it's like, man, I wish my spouse would give me the silent treatment. But for the most part, within healthy marriages, that's not how it works. And so it can be a difficult thing when we get the silent treatment. But I want to say that when the silent treatment is not coming from just somebody that we love, just another person, but when it's coming from God himself, it becomes that much more difficult. If you've got your Bibles this morning, turn to the book of 1 Samuel chapter 28, and we're going to continue on speaking about the life of Saul and the cautionary tales from his life. And in Psalm chapter 28, we're going to read verses 3 through 7 to begin with, and this is what it says. It says, "Now Samuel had died, and all Israel had mourned for him and buried him in Ramah, his own city. And Saul had put the mediums and the necromancers out of the land. And the Philistines assembled, and they came and they encamped at Shunem. And Saul gathered all Israel, and they encamped at Gilboa. When Saul saw the army of the Philistines, he was afraid, and his heart trembled greatly. And when Saul inquired of the Lord did not answer him, either by dreams or by Urim or by prophets. Then Saul said to his servants, 'Seek out for me a woman who is a medium, that I may go to her and inquire of her.' And his servant said to him, 'Behold, there is a medium at Endor.'" Now this Endor is not the planet of the Ewoks from Star Wars. This is a different Endor altogether. But where we have gotten to here is we're getting to the close of Saul's life. We're just a few chapters away from the very end, and we're getting into the final days of this king. Now, for 9 weeks, we've seen the disastrous effects of his life and the decisions that he's making, the decisions that are driven by fear and insecurity and faithlessness. It tells us in this passage that Samuel has died. Saul here has surrounded himself with yes men, and these yes men are not giving him good advice. What we find out in the verses preceding this is that David, who was one of the few people who was faithful and who provided a godly example, had left and gone and lived with the Philistines. Can you imagine this, that things are so bad in your own land that it's a better idea to go and live with the people you've been killing for 20 years? That's where David had gone. And it tells us in the beginning of this passage that Saul's old enemies, the Philistines, had amassed as they were coming in order to fight against Saul in this final battle. Now, as we come to the end of this time, there's a sense of bleakness that's marked by the circumstances that Saul is going through, as well as the palpable tension of God no longer speaking to Saul and no longer giving Saul any answers. Now, this is what we would call the penultimate episode of Saul's life. There's two episodes left. There's this one, and then there's the account of his death. And in this, we're going to examine the idea of the silence of God. We're going to deal with the idea of God not answering our prayers. And we're going to reflect on both how the godly respond to this and how the ungodly respond to the silence of God. So if you've got a bulletin and you have a pen and you want to follow along with your notes, the first observation we're going to make this morning is related to Saul's continuous dishonor of God. Saul's continual dishonor was met with silence. Now, does anybody here have somebody in their life that is kind of your go-to bailout person? There's that person that whether your trouble is financial or whether it's relational or whether it's legal, there is somebody that you can always go to and they will always help you out. They will always bail you out. They will always give you good counsel. Anybody have something like that in your life? Somebody that you know is just always there for you? You know, for a lot of people, it's parents or it's siblings or it's some friend that they've had for most of their life and they know that whatever I'm going through, that person is going to be there for me. But you know, these people, no matter how benevolent or how generous they are, if that's the extent of the relationship, they're going to come to realize that you see them as nothing more than a favor dispenser. Because for a lot of people, that's what it becomes. When you've got somebody who is there for you through everything, they become a favor dispenser. And sometimes that's what God becomes for us. Sometimes we start seeing God as just a dispenser of favors or as the bailout guy, and I ignore him or I disobey him or neglect him. But then when I need something from him, that's when I show up with my hand out and I'm asking him for something. This is what happens with God sometimes. And Saul, for nearly his entire reign as king, he had neglected the Lord. He had neglected obedience to God, and God had simply become his get out of jail free card. You know, no matter how much I mess up, no matter how bad things are in my life, God will come through because I rule his people. And God loves his people enough or too much to just abandon me because I'm the one who rules his people. He'll tolerate me in order to protect them. This is the kind of attitude that Saul had developed, that he could continue going through, messing up and rejecting God and failing and refusing to listen to God and follow after him, but yet still think that when the time came that he had a need, he could just say, God, tell me, and then God would respond and dispense the favor however he wanted it and whenever he wanted it. But there's a sense in this passage that God was done with Saul, that he'd come to the end of his patience with this king. Now, note two things that are going on here. Number one, Saul is in deep trouble. He's in deep trouble. What verses 3-5, the verses we just read, show is the sad state of affairs in Israel when the prophet has died, so the one who is the spiritual leader of the nation is gone. He's God. The Philistines are here. David, who is sort of the godly core of leadership, is gone out of the land and living with the Philistines. And in verse 5, this is what it tells us about Saul. When he saw the army of the Philistines, he was afraid and his heart trembled greatly. This phrase, his heart trembled greatly, the idea is the lev, the inner man, it's trembling and it's shaking in terror. The New Living Translation translate this that he was frantic with fear. This is the position that Saul finds himself in because he's realizing that everything at this point is out of his control. He's realizing that he can't overcome this insurmountable obstacle of the Philistine army that's come against him. And so what he's desperate for at this point as he's shaking in his boots is he's desperate and he's hungry for a word from God. See, even in the state that he was in, even in the state of disrepair that his spiritual life was in, he realized that what he needed in this circumstance and in this situation was God. And yet, throughout his whole reign, he had done everything in his power to put distance between he and God, and he had never taken the time to own up to the offenses that he had brought against God. He's living in open rebellion. And he's expecting that even in his open rebellion, that God is going to come to him and cater to his need and show up whenever he asks. And unfortunately, that's not how it works. It tells us in the scripture that God opposes the proud. So the ones who won't admit their wrongdoing, the ones who won't acknowledge that there's sin in their lives, the ones that won't acknowledge that what they've done is an offense to God. God opposes the proud, but it tells us he gives grace to the humble. So the one that will humble themselves and will acknowledge that I've sinned and will acknowledge that, something has gone on in my life and that I've offended God, those ones are the ones who receive God's grace. So Saul is in this time of deep need, and though God could hear, he was no longer answering. Now, it's important to notice in this passage that Saul attempts three ways to hear from God. He tries to hear from God through dreams and visions. He tries to hear from God through prophetic word. And he tries to hear from God through the Urim and the Thummim. He was trying every avenue that he knew, but there's a problem. If you guys remember a couple weeks ago, what had he done to the priests? He killed them, right? He had 85 of the priests killed. One guy escapes, and that one guy runs to David because it's the only place he can find protection. So who is going to cast the Urim and the Thummim and be able to determine what the will of God is? He's gotten rid of those people. He cut himself off from that avenue of hearing from God. And then another problem is the prophets. Who's just passed away? Samuel, right? And Samuel, who is the chief prophet, he's the one who's hearing from God and passing the word on. He's out of the picture. And the other prophets know what it is that God has spoken by Samuel, that God has rejected Saul's kingship. And so he's cut himself off from that avenue. And then what he wants to hear is he wants dreams or he wants some direct revelation. But here's the problem. God had already given Saul direct revelation. And that direct revelation was, Saul, I've abandoned you. I have rejected you. The kingdom no longer is going to belong to you. And you're going to be replaced by somebody who is a man after my own heart. See, Saul already had a direct word from God. He just didn't like that word from God. And a lot of times, I think that's how we are, right? Like, we've heard from God. If you've ever opened God's word and if you've ever read his word, you've heard from God. But a lot of times we don't want to listen to what this has to say. We don't want to hear what this has to say. We want a new word. We want a fresh word from God. We want something that's maybe not so harsh as what we read in here. We're in sin and we read the scriptures and it condemns our sin. And what we want is to hear something different from God. But again, that's not how God is speaking. On every level, Saul's actions had led to the point where God was no longer going to lead him. It was now consequence time for this man who had so rejected the leading of God. Now, this is a challenging idea when we approach this idea of the silence of God or of God not answering prayer, because we've probably, if you've been in church for any period of time, you've all heard it, right? God hears our prayers. God answers our prayers. And therefore, we make the assumption that regardless of what's going on with us or regardless of what's going on with our circumstance, that if we'll just pray, God will then answer those and give us the leadership and the guidance that we need. But I want you to consider the times in Scripture where it says that God doesn't answer and why it says he doesn't answer. In the book of Psalms, Psalm 66, verse 18, this is what the psalmist writes. If I had cherished iniquity in my heart, that is, if I had decided to hold on to my own sin and not relinquish it and not confess it and not repent of it, if I had cherished iniquity in my heart, the Lord would not have listened. Isaiah 59, 2, but your iniquities have made a separation between you and your God. Your sins have hidden his face from you so that he does not hear. That is your continuing iniquities. Not the iniquities you want dealt with, right? Not the ones that you've confessed to him. Not the ones that you've acknowledged that this is sin and therefore I'm going to turn these things over to God. But the iniquities that we hold on to, they've created separation. Now listen, the separation is not from God's love. We know from Romans chapter 8, verses 35 through 39, that nothing can separate us from the love of God that's in Christ Jesus. But it's a separation from his blessing and it's a separation from his intervention in our difficult situations. It's a separation from the action of God. Proverbs 28:9 says, if one turns away his hearing from the law, even his prayer is an abomination. Like, think about that. If we turn away from listening to what God has to say, even the prayers we pray can be called an abomination to God. Isaiah 1:15, when you spread out your hands, I will hide my eyes from you. Even though you make many prayers, I will not listen because your hands are full of blood. There comes a point where God is saying, I'm not listening anymore to the constant babble of these prayers. What I'm listening for now is the prayer of confession or the prayer of repentance. You're begging me for blessing. You're begging me for direction. You're begging me to lead you some way. And what I'm listening for right now is the prayer of confession and repentance. Deliverance, blessing, hope, I can't hear you. Now listen, we know from the scriptures that there is no sin that cannot be forgiven, that God will forgive the trespasses, but something has to happen before he forgives those. That is, we must confess those. We must repent of those. We must turn them over to him. And it tells us if we confess our sins, he's what? He's faithful and just to forgive us our sins, and not just to forgive us the sins, but to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. But what it requires is a willingness to relinquish those things. But instead of repentance, what we get from Saul is him going in a different direction. And this is where we see Saul's propensity to try to fix things himself. And we see his propensity for shirking his responsibilities. And we see his propensity for letting fear drive what he does. It all comes to roost here because instead of asking the question, why is God not hearing me? Or why is God not responding to me? That's the better question. Why is he not doing this? He decided that he was going to find another way. If God won't answer, I will find my own solution. And listen, we are never in a good place spiritually when we start concluding that if God won't answer me, I'll find my own way. I'll do my own thing. Because God has made it clear what he wants us to do. He's made it clear how he wants us to come to him and how he wants us to live. So when we come to that place where we say, fine, God, I'll do it myself, we're in spiritual trouble. And that leads us to the second observation here. When God would not answer, Saul took an ill-advised bypass. So if you've got your Bibles, look at verses 8 through 15 with me. This is what it says. So Saul disguised himself, and he put on other garments, and he went, he and two men with him, and they came to the woman by night, and he said, divine for me a spirit, and bring up for me whomever I shall name to you. And the woman said, surely you know that what Saul has done, how he's cut off the mediums and the necromancers from the land when they are from the land. Why are you then laying a trap for my life to bring about my death? But Saul swore to her by the Lord. And I want you guys to just consider what's happening here. Saul, knowing that it's wrong to go to these people, he's the one who cast them out of the land because that's what God desired, swears by the very same Lord who had said these things were evil, that this woman would not die. He says, as the Lord lives, no punishment shall come upon you for this thing. Then the woman said, whom shall I bring up for you? And he said, bring up Samuel for me. And the woman saw Samuel, she cried out with a loud voice. And the woman said to Saul, why have you deceived me? You are Saul. And the king said to her, do not be afraid. What do you see? And the woman said to Saul, I see a God coming up out of the earth. And he said to her, what is his appearance? And she said, an old man is coming up, and he's wrapped in a robe. And Saul knew that it was Samuel, and he bowed with his face to the ground and paid homage. And then Samuel said to Saul, why have you disturbed me? Are you bringing me up? And Saul answered, I am in great distress, for the Philistines are warring against me, and God has turned away from me and answers me no more, either by prophets or by dreams. Therefore, I have summoned you to tell you or to tell me what I shall do. Have anybody here ever taken a bypass or a shortcut that turned out not to be a shortcut in the end? When my family in 2010, we went over to England and Scotland and we took a road trip and we had just crossed from England into Scotland and there was this castle we wanted to go see. And so we drove out to see it. It was this beautiful thing, wonderful gardens. And then when we were getting ready to go back, we wanted to determine, is there a shorter way to get back than going all the way back to the freeway and then going north to get to Glasgow? And so, you know, we looked and it was like, it's like an hour to get back out and get back up there. So we said, let's look and see if we can find another path. And find another path we did. And so we took off to the north out through this road that before long turned out to be like a goat path. And on this goat path, there were boulders strewn all over the place. And you're going between these stone fences and you're driving down by the river. And we passed gypsy caravans along the river. And we are out in the scary wilds of Scotland. And what should have been an hour going back out and up took us 2 or 3 hours to get where we were going. See, those bypasses, those shortcuts that we take sometimes that we think are going to be quicker and they think they're going to be easier actually turn out to be far more difficult and have much worse consequences. The road was blocked by silence for Saul, and so we decided he would try a bypass. He would try a shortcut, and he had no idea how costly that shortcut would be. So let's break this down. First of all, he openly violated God's commands that he had previously obeyed. Now, it tells us at the beginning of the passage that Saul had already cast all the necromancers and mediums out of the land. Now, if you don't know what a necromancer or a medium is, mediums and necromancers are those who commune with the dead. Necromancers are those who try to bring up the spirits of the dead in order to gain information from them. Mediums are those who deal in the occult and in the spiritual world, trying to connect with spirits. And so God had told them to cast these people out. Leviticus 26. This is one of the prohibitions that God gave to his people. In Deuteronomy 18, 10 through 12, he said, to go to these people and to seek their counsel was an abomination to God. It carried with it the death penalty. It's a capital offense. Why? Because these people were not just doing tricks. They were communing with evil spirits. It's not that they didn't have power, but their power wasn't coming from God. It was coming from God's enemy. And he didn't want his people communing with those who were in league with evil spirits or having demonic encounters. And Saul knew this, and this is why he had kicked them out of the land, and this is why they were all gone. But now, as he's trying to figure out things for himself, and he's not getting the answer from God that he wants, he decides to take this shortcut. He's going to go and seek counsel from one who communes with demons. Now, let me say this a little bit slower. He is trying to discern God's will by going and consulting God's enemy. Like, this is how far Saul has gone outside the realm of rational and reasonable. God is not answering him anymore, so I'm going to go to a medium. I'm going to go to a necromancer. I'm going to go to somebody who is communing and hearing from spirits that are not the Spirit of God, that are not the Holy Spirit, and I'm going to seek out what it is I'm supposed to be doing from these people. That's where he's gotten to. Now, listen, if we ever find ourselves trying to elicit God's favor through God's enemy or through that which he is in opposition to, we're in trouble. Because there's no back door into blessing through evil. You know, in our lives, we might own a business and our business is struggling and we decide to cut corners and to cheat and then somehow expect that God is going to continue to bless our business after we're doing things that are ungodly. If there's not a back door to blessing through evil. We might be struggling in our marriage and we decide to employ the world's means to try to deal with those troubles in our marriage and then we expect God to bless that as we try to do our own thing. We might be struggling and stressed and overwhelmed and then we determine that something's got to get cut out of my life, so we cut out our time of devotion with the Lord and we cut out our time of service to the Lord and then we somehow expect that God is going to continue to bless us and we don't find blessing by going through the back door of doing things that God has said are wrong or evil. And yet how often do we think that that's the case? I'm God's child. I'm a follower of him. It doesn't matter what I'm doing. God's going to bless me nonetheless. Saul openly violates God's command that he had previously obeyed. And the thing is that he recognized that it was wrong. That's the next blank in there. He recognized it was wrong to do so. Now, despite the fact that he has wandered so far away from the Lord, he still gets that this isn't right. And we know this, first of all, because the medium actually tells him. Like, he goes into her and she says, you know what Saul has done, right? Saul's cast all of us out. And if I do this for you, it could be my death. So the woman who is communing with the spirits is telling him, you know, Saul has said that this is wrong. It's a reminder to him of what he had done. But then beyond that, secondly, look at how he's coming to find this woman. It tells us he comes in disguise. He hides himself. And it tells us he comes at night. Why is he doing that? Well, part of it's because it's in occupied, Philistine-occupied land, but the other part is that he knows that it's wrong. He doesn't want to be recognized in doing this. Listen, if there ever comes a point where we're doing something and we find ourselves looking around to make sure nobody's watching and seeing what we're doing, it's probably a good idea not to do that thing. because it's a recognition that what we're doing is wrong. What we're doing is in disobedience to God. But what we see for Saul is that it's all about appearances. Like, we see this all along the way, right? He's constantly hiding his true self. He's constantly hiding his true motives. He's always trying to look spiritual. You see it even when the spirit of Samuel shows up here on the scene. He bows down to his face, right? He's still trying to keep up all the appearances and trying to hide the things that he's doing that's wrong, yet he knows that it's wrong. And in verses 9 through 12, clearly the medium is fooled, right? She doesn't recognize that it's him until Samuel shows up here. But once she starts the process, she knows the truth. And one of the things I want to point out in this passage is that when this woman divines up the spirit of Samuel in this, she seems genuinely shocked. Like, she seems that she is genuinely afraid. If you look at the way that it says it here in the passage, Saul swears nothing is going to happen. The woman says, "Who do you want to bring up?" Samuel. And then in verse 12, it says, when the woman saw Samuel. So we get the impression here that Saul can't see anything yet. Just the woman can see what's going on at this point. Saul will eventually communicate with Samuel, but the woman sees. And what it tells us in verse 12 is that when she saw, she cried out with a loud voice. Now, what that means is that she screamed at the top of her lungs. It's a statement of fear. It's a statement of surprise. Now, there are some commentators who, when they talk about this passage, what they say is that this woman had probably never actually successfully brought anyone back at any point, right? That she didn't have the power to bring the dead back here, and that when she saw him, she was genuinely surprised. Like, even today, there are people that practice occult practices, psychics, mediums, tarot card readers, stuff like that, who are charlatans, right? They're not actually communing with anything. They're just playing on people's fears and expectations. And it seems that perhaps maybe that's what this woman was. But at least this time, it seems from a straightforward reading of the text that she actually did make contact. And what Robert Bergen tells us is that the reason she's even allowed to make contact here is so that Samuel can be the one who speaks these words of final judgment upon Saul for what he's doing. So if we look at what's going on here, we see, first of all, he openly violates God's command that he'd previously obeyed. We see he recognizes that he was wrong to do it, but then in a very Saul fashion, he justifies himself. Now, you saw in verse 10 the way he tells this woman, he invokes the name of the Lord and he says that you're not going to be punished for what you do. And that's false, right? Like, God is going to punish this woman because this is something that he has said that they're not supposed to be doing. There is going to be judgment for this woman, but Saul, what he says to her is, as the Lord lives, no punishment will come upon you for this thing. He is playing God, he is appealing to God, and he is dishonoring God all in the same thing. In this moment, that's what he's doing, and in his mind, it's perfectly fine. But when the spirit of Samuel arrives on the scene and he begins to have this discussion with Saul about what's going on, Samuel asks the question, you know, essentially, why are you doing this? Why have you called me? Why have you done this? And if you look at his response, you will see he says, I'm in great distress, for the Philistines are warring against me. And listen, and God has turned away from me and answers me no more, either by prophets or by dreams. Therefore, it's for this reason that I have summoned you in this way. I was in trouble, and the Lord failed to come through, and therefore I had to go down this path in order to hear from you. Like, his defense here is the same as before. It's always somebody else's fault. I had to do this. God didn't come through, and therefore I had to do it. And it's just like the day he lost the kingdom. It's just like Adam in the garden, right? When Adam sins in the garden and God confronts him about it, what does he say? He says, it's not my fault, it's the woman. But it's not just the woman, it's what? The woman you gave me. God, in a roundabout way, this is kind of your fault. Because I was doing just fine before you gave me this woman. when Saul gets caught the first time, when he fails to put the king to death, and when King Agag, and he fails in all of that, what does he say? He says, it's not my fault, it's the people around me. The people kept this stuff. Like, it's not my fault. And what he says here, when Samuel is aghast at what happens, and he's like, why have you disturbed me? Why have you called me up? What is happening here? His answer is, God's not listening anymore. So I had to do this. And that's just Saul, again, justifying himself. Why? Because in Saul's mind, there's always someone else to blame. It's never his fault. He never has a reason to confess. He's always the victim. He's never the perpetrator. And if you want to know whether somebody is far away from the heart of God, that is a clear indicator, is that they can never accept the blame. They can never acknowledge that they're wrong. They're always the victim. If you find somebody that is always the victim, they are far from the heart of God, because they're refusing to acknowledge that there is blame there. They're refusing to acknowledge their own part that they played. Saul did this because Saul thought it was a good idea. And when he's confronted about it, he says, it's just because God didn't answer. I had to do this. The bypass that he took was evil. It dishonored God. And it was the final straw. This is the final straw in God's tolerance of Saul. You know, there's one clear thing we know in Scripture. Well, there's lots of clear things in Scripture, but here is a clear thing in Scripture. James 4:17 tells us, whoever knows the right thing to do and fails to do it, for him it's sin. When we know what's right and wrong, and I would be willing to guess that, you know, except for the very smallest of us here, pretty much everybody here knows what's right and wrong and what's good and evil. And if we know the right thing to do and the wrong thing that we shouldn't be doing, and yet we pursue doing it, it tells us in Scripture that that is sin. When we know what's right and we know what's wrong and we do it anyway, that is open rebellion. That is a denial of God's place and God's authority in our lives. And that's exactly what Saul is doing. He didn't get the answer that he wanted. The road was blocked. And so he's like, I'll take a shortcut. I'll take this bypass. And as he takes the bypass through the woods, he drives off a cliff. And that's what brings us to the last section, verses 16 through 20. This is Samuel's response. It says, and Samuel said, why then do you ask me, since the Lord has turned from you and become your enemy? The Lord has done to you as he spoke by me, for the Lord has torn the kingdom out of your hand and given it to your neighbor David, because you did not obey the voice of the Lord and did not carry out his fierce wrath against Amalek. Therefore, the Lord has done this thing to you this day. Samuel says, this thing that's happening here, this isn't because you're a victim. This is the just deserts for what you have done and continued to do throughout your entire life as a king. God is just doing what he said he was going to do. That's why you're in this insurmountable position, because God is true to his word. Verse 19, he says, moreover, the Lord will give Israel also with you into the hand of the Philistines, and tomorrow you and your son shall be with me. Like, that's an ominous statement, right? The spirit of Samuel, who has come up from the dead, and he says, tomorrow you and your sons are going to be with me. The Lord will give the army of Israel into the hand of the Philistines. Then Saul fell at once, full length on the ground, filled with fear because of the words of Samuel. And there was no strength in him, for he had nothing to eat all day and all night. So this is the third observation. Seeking favor, Saul found condemnation. Seeking favor, he found condemnation. Now, what this reminds me of is it reminds me of the end of the movie Raiders of the Lost Ark. You guys all saw that at some point. Most of you probably did. At the end of the Raiders of the Lost Ark, the Nazis have spent the whole movie trying to get what? The Ark, right? The Ark of the Covenant. Why? Because they felt like it was some power object that they could use to control the world. And so at the end of the movie, they finally have it. They get it there, and they bring their little fake priest in there, and they open the lid because, you know, inside of this, there's got to be some kind of power for us to do the thing that we're going to want to do. But they don't find power in there. They find death. They find these horrifying specters that bring about death. Now, Saul imagined that he could go down this path of going and consulting God's enemies and yet still come out on the far side of it and receive a word from God. He thought that he could go through all of this and he could dishonor God and yet still come out smelling like roses on the other side. But once the lid of this action was opened, all he found is death. The two things he found, first of all, is a rebuke for his continual rebellion. Now, when Samuel shows up, there's not a hi, there's not a hello, there's not a haven't seen you in a while because I've been dead. There's nothing like this. There is no warm welcome greeting. There is, why have you disturbed me by bringing me up? And when he poses the question and he's like, God wouldn't answer and therefore I needed you to answer me, his response in verse 16 is something along the lines of, if the Lord himself is against you, what did you imagine I was going to do? Look at that. Look at verse 16. He says, why then do you ask me, since the Lord has turned from you and become your enemy? He's like, Saul, you just keep doing the same thing over and over again. Now, I've heard this is the definition of insanity, doing the same thing over and over again and hoping to get a different result. Saul continues over and over again to do it his way, to continue to pursue his thing, to continue to discount what God has said, and then expects on the far side of it, he's going to get the blessings, he's going to get the rewards. It's what he does over and over and over again. Rick talked about this last week, his hard-headedness and his hard-heartedness just kept leaving him in the same spot over and over again. No matter what he did, he kept getting in the same spot. And so in 17, Samuel gives clarity. The Lord has done to you as he spoke. This is happening because God is faithful, and God is the one who has allowed this to happen. God is the one who allowed the Philistines to muster. God is the one who has allowed you to be in this position because it's time for you to feel the consequences of your persistent and continuous rebellion. It's a rebuke and a reminder that Saul is not a victim. He's getting the just reward, the just deserts for his way of living. And so he receives a rebuke and then finally a promise of final judgment. The games are over. God is done tolerating the failures of Saul. He's at the point where he's asking for demonic help. He's at the point where he's abandoned praying to God and he's now starting to ask God's enemies for direction. Nothing good is coming out of his reign, and so it's the time to put it down once and for all. Saul was hoping that what he would get from Samuel is a go up, the Lord is with you, and what he instead gets is the nation's going to be defeated. The people are going to suffer because of what you've done, but then it gets even more personal. In the next 24 hours, you and your family are going to die. Your sons are going to die. Rebellion will not be tolerated forever. God will not allow those who claim his name to continue to dishonor him over and over and over again. Because God is holy, and God is pure, and God is worthy of worship. And when we decide that we're going to take our lives and we're going to put them in opposition to him and that we're going to persistently run and continue to do things our own way and try to live our own way, without honoring the Lord, there is going to be consequences for that. So this is the end of Saul's story. One more week, and we'll talk about his death next Sunday morning. But what we've seen again and again with this guy is an unwillingness or an inability to learn, to grow, to change direction, to make decisions that are not going to hurt him and the people around him. Because, you know, when you look at Saul's life, what you notice is that Saul is not the only one who suffers. His decisions, his actions, they hurt everybody around him. And that's true of us as well sometimes, right? We make decisions in life and the consequences don't just fall on us, they fall on our kids and they fall on our friends and our families and our communities. And the things that we do affect other people around us. And this is where the sin that we embrace and the iniquity that we hold on to and that we cherish, it falls not just upon us, the consequences, it falls on the people around us and on the people that we love. And this is where we understand that Saul, his heart is so far from God that he can't even think not just about his own well-being, but he can't even think about the well-being of the people around him, his family, his sons. When he is put to death, his sons are going to die with him. And so as we examine these cautionary tales, let this be a cautionary tale to each and every one of us. The end result of this kind of life is always pain. The end result to this kind of life is always sorrow because God is just. And he ensures that if we decide that we are not going to take the grace of forgiveness and repentance, and if we don't take the grace of his forgiveness in our lives, then there's going to be a consequence that is paid in our lives and in the lives of other people around us. When we abandon God's way for our way, what awaits is not success or victory, it's consequence and pain. Now listen, if you want to know what the godly life is all about, it's not complex, right? This is the godly life in a nutshell. God's things, God's way. Every time. Like that's not complex. It's not easy, right? Because the flesh is constantly battling against us. The world is constantly telling us that we need to pursue after other things. There's complicating factors, but the godly life is this. We do God's thing. We do it in God's way. We submit ourselves to his leadership. And yet so many struggle because our flesh is always striving for control. And if you want Saul in a nutshell, that is Saul in a nutshell right there. His flesh, his desire, his way. He was always elevating it above God's. And the end result of it is this kind of a life. You want to know how somebody who starts off being chosen by God and being placed as a leader of God's people can end up at this place? Here it is. My way first. Constantly and consistently over and over again. If that's the kind of life that we live, the results are going to be similar in our lives. So, how do we apply a passage like this today? Well, there's two ways I'm going to apply it, and one of them is very direct and very straightforward and very simple, and it's this. God takes offense when we look to his enemy for help. God takes offense when we try to do things our own way and we try to somehow figure them out on our own way. The devil's ways, the ones that Saul pursued, they're never our ways. So if nobody has ever told you this before, don't be going to mediums or tarot card readers or palm readers or anything else like this. Why? Because their business is in the occult. Their business is communing with spirits, not the Holy Spirit, not seeking God's direction, not putting trust in what God has done, but putting trust in other things, pursuing after other answers and other ways to learn and grow in knowledge. It's never going to help us. It's only going to hurt us. When God didn't answer Saul, he decided he would try plan B, but here's the reality. There is no plan B, right? I hope we all understand this. It's God's way or no way. There is no plan B. If we want to receive God's blessing, if we want to experience God's favor, if we want to walk in a way that's godly, there is no plan B. There is the way that God has laid out, and we follow this, and we walk in this. And if we have any question about it, and we're wondering what it looks like, there is a manual. Here is a field manual for you, and this will tell you how to walk in godliness. God's things, God's way. There is no, I'll do it myself. There's no, I'll ask someone else. It's obey the Lord, trust the Lord, seek the Lord, period. And then the second way that we apply this is in learning to ask the question, if God is not answering me, why not? Listen, of all the questions that you can ask in life, that's going to be one of the most valuable questions that you ever learn to ask. I've been praying, I've been asking God, and he's not answering me, so why is he not answering me? Now listen, there could be a number of reasons why. One could be is that God is answering and we're just not listening because we haven't yet learned what God's voice sounds like. And listen, you want to train yourself in what God's voice sounds like? Here it is. Again, it's the guidebook. It's the training manual. If we want to know what God sounds like, we will find it in his word. So sometimes it's just that we need to learn how he speaks to us. Sometimes God's telling us to wait. And the answer is forthcoming. And so what we need is to learn patience. But before we get to either one of those, the question that we should probably be asking is this. Is there something that I'm doing that's putting distance between me and God? Have I clogged the output valve of God's blessing through my rebellion? I'm going to tell you, a lot of times, that's exactly what's behind it. Is that we're just out here living our best life now, living however we want to live, doing whatever we want to do, and then we're asking God for direction and we're not receiving it. and we think somehow the system's broken. But in reality, if we would just take a few minutes to be introspective and ask the question, is there unresolved sin in my life? Am I walking in rebellion to God? We might come to that conclusion and go, I need to pray and ask for forgiveness, and I need to confess my sins so that I'm forgiven, but then also cleansed of that iniquity. It's a question we need to learn to ask. God, is it maybe me? Is it maybe that the receptor is broken? Not that you're not speaking, but rather, I'm not hearing you. If we don't know, it's a good question to ask. This is the question Job asks in Job 13:3. How many are my iniquities and my sins? Make me know my transgression and my sin. This is what David prays in Psalm 139, 23, and 24. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my concerns. See if there is any offensive or any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. God, search me. Reveal if there's something offensive in me. And if there is, God, forgive me. Restore me and lead me in a different direction. You know, if Saul had spent any time in his life just being introspective enough to ask the question, is the problem maybe me? It would have been a very different life for Saul. But he could never get there, right? Because it was always somebody else. It was always somebody else's fault. It was always somebody else's issue. And if we, looking at these cautionary tales all through the book of 1 Samuel, can learn to ask the question, God, is it something in my own life, in my own heart? We may find that we live a much more victorious and God-honoring life. The prayer of petition and the prayer of confession, even in the deepest darkness, that is the prayer that God will respond to. And so if we ever find ourselves experiencing the silence of God, that's the question to ask. God, demonstrate for me if there is something in my heart and in my life. Reveal that to me because I want to walk in your way. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day that you've given us. And Lord, we thank you so much for the truth of your word. And Lord God, we're grateful to you for the way in which you have led and guided us. Lord, we are grateful for the way in which you have given us your word. And Lord, I pray that each and every one of us would be serious, that we would be serious about following after you. That Lord, we'd be serious about sin. Lord, that if there is some grievous and wicked way in our lives and in our hearts, that, Lord, we would be willing to be open to you and listen to you and just ask you, Lord, just reveal it to me. I want to be in the right with you. Lord, don't let us be like Saul, constantly making excuses, constantly looking for another way, constantly trying to find some other means of gaining favor or answers from you. Lord, let us be a people who are receptive. And if we bump up against silence, Lord, let us be introspective and let us be willing to listen and willing to change if need be. Lord God, we love you and we thank you so much for what you do. We realize that you are the one who advocates for us, Lord. We realize you are the one who fights for us. And so, Lord, we turn our lives over to you. We want our lives to be doing your things in your ways. Lord, just give us the strength and the guidance to do that. We love you, and we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Is the battle, you see my victory. When all I see is a mountain, you see my Jesus, there's nothing impossible for you. When I see out the ashes, you see the beauty. When all I see is a cross, God, you see the empty tomb.
Before our service ends today, we're going to do one more thing, and that is we are going to participate in the ordinance of baptism. And Hamish Patterson is coming forth to be baptized today, and Hamish has made a proclamation of faith in Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior, and we know that what follows that proclamation of faith is to follow him in believers' baptism. And so believers' baptism is just that. It's a thing that we, as those who have trusted in Christ, do, where we picture what has happened with Christ. And so there's a burial into the waters, and then there's a resurrection that happens. Michaela, can you turn this over this direction? And then there's a resurrection that happens, and it pictures what Christ has done for us and what we know will happen for us as well, that just as we have died to sin, we've been buried with Christ, we are resurrected with him as well. And so that's what Hamish is going to be demonstrating for us today. So Hamish, if you go ahead and... This water is probably very cold, so empathize with our friend here.
All right.
We put the water in here yesterday. Let's step down right here.
Oh, you want me to step in?
Yeah, step in it.
All right.
Yep.
Oh, it's cold.
Yeah, it's cold. And so before you go down in here, we'll say everything. Hamish, have you placed your faith and trust in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior?
I have.
Okay, so go ahead and sit. Scoot up as far forward as you can there.
All right.
So based on this profession of faith, I now baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of his death, raised in the likeness of his resurrection to walk in newness of life. It's always one of my favorite things to do in ministry, which is to baptize people, because it's a demonstration that God is still calling people to himself. God is still changing lives. He's still bringing people into a relationship with him. And this is a way for us to be able to picture that for all the world to see. And so make sure you guys take some time today to congratulate him, to speak with him, and then also to talk with all of those who joined the church this morning. We're a part of this family together, and we want to serve and honor the Lord together. I'm going to pray for our food. I'll let you guys know, Ben has been over here grilling, but he also went and made brisket last night, so we've got brisket. But I'm going to tell you, there is not enough brisket for everybody to have all the brisket they want. There's 10 pounds of brisket, so if you get some, just get one piece so that you can taste it and marvel at the barbecuing skills of Mr. Goffinette over there. But then we've got other food as well. We've got all the stuff that's been brought. We've got burgers. We've got dogs. And so, parents, what I'm going to ask you to do is before, go grab your kids, bring your kids, and go through the line with them so that they don't also just grab a ton of stuff. So... If you'll grab them and then just head over there, let me pray, and then we will dismiss. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this day that you've given us, and Lord, we're grateful to you for the way in which you call us and the way in which you love us, and Lord, the way in which you have given us a relationship with you. And Lord, we thank you for the time that we had today to be in your word and to just examine what it says about your silence and what it says about walking in your way. And Lord, I pray that we would just be serious about that and dedicated to it. And Lord, as we begin our time of fellowship and have our picnic today, Lord, I pray that you would just bless the food that we're about to receive. And I pray that you would... just allow this to be a wonderful time of bonding and of family joy together as a church. We love you. We thank you for all you do, and we pray these things in the precious name of Jesus. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. All right, grab your kids, grab some food, and you can meet back over here. Or there's going to be lots of games and stuff to play. Mary will be in charge, I think is in charge of those. So listen for announcements about games. So go ahead, grab kids, grab food.